This is Liberty Under Attack Radio, hosted by Shane and Matt, your place for documented truth and where freedom is the only agenda. We must end the terror war.
And we are live. Good evening and welcome to another broadcast of Liberty Under Attack Radio here on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. I'm your host, Shane, broadcasting live from the tax farm known as Central Illinois. Matt will not be joining us this evening, but we're going to be joined by a very special guest here in just a moment. Our guest will be Lou Feen from Freedom Feens Radio. But as always, before we move forward, there is some housekeeping that needs to be taken care of first. I returned from the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest with a few articles to write and a debrief video to do. I've been pretty busy with that up until till Wednesday evening this week. The first article I came out with is titled The Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest 3, A Liberating Experience. This one ended up a little longer than I expected, but it was necessary if I was going to show the readers why this festival was so significant to me. And that'll be one of the subjects discussed on this evening's broadcast. Next, I wrote an article titled, Are You Just Anti-Government or Are You Anti-Police Too? This one discusses my encounter with a local police extortionist on the way to a Freedom Festival, which it's kind of interesting. But I also completed the post-MPLC debrief video, which is available on the LUA YouTube channel, where I briefly run through a few things I found important from the festival. Definitely make sure to go check those out. They're all available at libertyunderattack.com on the front page of the site. And again, for that video, that is at youtube.com/libertyunderattack if you want to go directly there for it. I'd also like to inform you guys on what to expect from LUA Radio for the remainder of the month. Next week, we'll be joined by Davi Barker, the Muslim agorist. We'll be discussing voluntarism, Bitcoin, and the viability of Islam being compatible with anarchy. I'm definitely interested in that conversation. I know a little bit about Davi. I know he's been on. I know he's been on Freedom Feens a few times. I've heard him on there, so it'll definitely be an interesting discussion. The following week, we'll be joined by Derek Bros of the Conscious Resistance to discuss activism, anarchy, and the merging of anarchy with spirituality. We'll definitely be having on some interesting guests, so make sure to tune in to Liberty Under Attack Radio at least this month. We'd like you to tune in every week, but at least for this month. And if you miss out on a broadcast, make sure to go to fprnradio.com/Liberty Under Attack to catch all of the archives. So yeah, as you can tell, I certainly enjoyed myself at the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. It was an amazing change of pace to be around philosophically consistent, like-minded folks that live the non-aggression principle and respect private property, including one's own body. It was an experience unlike any in my life. And contrary to mainstream belief, it was not chaotic. It was peaceful, voluntary, and consensual. It's what I would imagine the victory party to look like, as Cal Molinay would put it. So today I got back from Southern Illinois. It was my mom's birthday weekend, and she wanted to go on a wine tour through Southern Illinois. Went down. It was about a four-hour drive down. It was a pretty good time, I would say. Pretty good time. But I got home about 1:30 today, and was exhausted. So I did just wake up from a nap before the show. So I guess kind of bear with me if I'm a little tired today. It's been a busy last couple of weeks. So the number to call is 218-895-3818 or on Skype at FPRN Radio Live. If you have anything to add to the discussion this evening, feel free to give us a call. So at this time, I'll bring in our guest, Lou. Lou, thank you so much for agreeing to come on in rather short notice. Definitely appreciate it. How are you doing this evening?
Oh, I'm doing fine. Thanks for having me. I sure appreciate the invitation. And yeah, you do have some interesting guests coming up. Davi is one of the co-hosts on the Freedom Feens, and he's just a blast to talk to. Really smart, really funny, too. And I had the pleasure of meeting Derek Bros a couple months ago. He was up in the Detroit area doing a story on Detroit's threat management and then a local community effort at rehabbing some old beat up school to turn it into something else.
Awesome. Awesome. And Davi is he's an entrepreneur, too. I think he has a couple Bitcoin projects that he's doing at this time.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, he stays pretty busy. He doesn't burn a whole lot of daylight.
Yeah, that's kind of what I gathered from looking around on his site a little bit. And yeah, Derek Brosably, interesting. I read his book. I honestly can't for the life of me remember what it was called. But yeah, it is available on the consciousresistance.com. And it was certainly interesting the way that he kind of merges spirituality with anarchy. So I'm definitely excited to have him on and kind of discuss that subject, because it's one I've not really dug into at all. Definitely have not.
Yeah, when I met him, we didn't really go into that too much. He stayed with some friends of mine. I think he did, at least one night. But anyway, I did some shuttling around of him, so taking him to a couple different locations. But yeah, we got a chance to chat. Like I said, really nice guy, really interesting too.
Mm-hmm. Right on, right on. So Freedom Feens, that is, you mentioned you're a co-host of that show, and I've actually, on Friday and, today I was, had time to listen to a few broadcasts, and I listened to five of them. It's definitely an interesting show. I like the layout a lot. So why don't you tell, the listeners a little about yourself, and also kind of, tell them about, Freedom Feens and what you guys are doing over there.
Okay. Well, I am a co-host of Freedom Feens radio show. It broadcasts on another network, and I think we're on like 34 or 35 terrestrial radio stations, multiple streaming networks, multiple pirate radio stations, and just all sorts of places. What's really nice about it is there's probably about 12 co-hosts on there, and we have a couple from Scotland, the Greens, and it's really interesting to listen to the different things that they do, you know, that they talk about. They also have a podcast called the Greening Out Podcast. Davy Barker already mentioned he's on there, and he is a Muslim agorist. Also, we have you met Diana down at Liberty Fest, Diana Kyler.
I don't think I met her, but I am aware of her.
Okay. Well, anyway, she's down in North Carolina, and she's really fun to listen to. Randy England, you should have met him at Liberty Fest.
Yep.
He is a former prosecutor, now a criminal defense attorney in Jefferson City, Missouri. So he throws his little thing in there. We have a guy who lives in Mexico City who was born and raised in Venezuela. As a matter of fact, I think there may even be a picture of him shaking hands with Hugo Chavez when he was a boy. But anyway, that's Hugo. Bill Bupert, he's with ZeroGov.com, and he's, you know, just a wealth of historical information and just a really powerful speaker, and also another great guy. Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker, his podcast has gone away, and he's come over to do Freedom Feens full time. But, you know, another very interesting person, whether you're just talking about liberty or just camping or, you know, RVing, motorhomes, stuff like that. I mean, just a really nice, interesting guy to chat with. Let's see now, who else is in there? it's almost hard to keep track of everybody.
I noticed MK Lords is on there too, isn't she?
Yeah, MK's on there. I think I've only done one show with her, and that was a little while back. But yeah, she's on there, and she's pretty active in the Bitcoin world. Mm-hmm. Diana Davison, I think the past three shows I've done, she has been on there, and her YouTube channel is Feminism LOL, so she goes and bashes the feminists and the social justice warriors.
Good for her.
yeah, good for her. And I don't want to take sides and pick favors, but Jim Babb is one of my favorites, because he and I play so well off of each other as far as the humor and the comedy, and mm-hmm. I don't want to say that we're trying to one-up each other, but that's just how it works out. And Jim's really involved with Fully Informed Jury Association. He was up in, I believe it was New York City, for the Ross Ulbricht trial.
Okay. Awesome. Hey, you guys, there's definitely a lot of hosts there. I thought I had like an idea. Like, I thought they're like, oh, maybe like three hosts. And I listened to like five or six broadcasts, and there was different people on every single time. So that was kind of interesting.
Yeah. Oh, wait, I forgot one. I'm probably forgetting about five of them. But Nick Hazelton, he has the Anarcho-Yakitalist podcast. He is a 16-year-old yak farmer, and he's been doing the show since age 15. As a matter of fact, he was getting school credit for doing his podcast and coming on the radio show. So Michael Dean, the ringleader of this circus, was filling out Nick's report card, grading him on attendance and performance and everything else.
That's pretty cool. 16 years old.
Yeah.
16 years old. Wow.
Started awesome. At 15.
Good for him. Good for him. I like I like seeing younger people taking an interest in this at all. But hosting his own show at age 15 is that's pretty significant.
Yep. And being on radio.
Yeah, no joke. No joke. So, I mentioned this to you in the pre-show, but I do want to let my listeners know about it as well if they're interested in using it. I haven't had a chance to use it yet, but all I hear is good things about it. So you guys over there, the Feens, don't use Skype much, do they?
No, we have done away with Skype. Now that Bill Buford has a Mac, he's using Feen Phone, and it's a really good communications network. It doesn't have the compression or noise reduction, I should say, that Skype offers, but it's also in the beginning phases too. But it's open source. It works really well. You can have two or three people on there. I think we've had a dozen people on there at one time, but you can have them on there. And like with you and I being on Skype right now, if we spoke over each other, one of us would get crunched out and you get that electronic squishy sound. Mm-hmm. And you don't have that with Feen Phone, so we can actually talk over each other in the loudest winds.
Well, good deal, good deal. But yeah, it definitely intrigues me. I'm going to have to take a look at that and see how I like it. But like I said, I haven't heard anything bad about it, so I'm sure I'll enjoy it. So I guess let's move forward. The Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, you did attend, and you did a lot of cooking, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm 3 for 3 for Liberty Fest, and that's probably the one thing that I spend the majority of my time doing is cooking. I have what's called an assault kitchen, and the assault kitchen, to put it simply, is a very intricate, blinged-out cooking setup, and I've got a little Coleman two-burner stove, a little barbecue grill, but when you look at all the shelves and cupboards and everything else that go in the actual setup of the assault kitchen, that's what makes it the assault kitchen. So, it's an assault kitchen based upon appearance. It has a shoulder thing that goes up too.
Awesome, awesome, good deal. Yeah, unfortunately, I didn't have a chance to try out any of your cooking. I heard it was spectacular, though. Maybe next year.
Yeah, maybe definitely. Shame on you. Shame on you. I know. When did you leave? Did you leave Sunday night or Monday morning?
I left Sunday evening after I did 45 minutes of the show and then took off because I did have a 4-hour drive home and I had to go to work on Monday. So, yeah, unfortunately, I had to leave a day early.
Okay. Well, I had a 9.5-hour drive.
Fair enough.
So, but anyway, no, I'm just busting your chops. I stopped and camped along Lake Michigan on the way home. So I live in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan in a little area called Bear Saskatchewan. So it's a cross between Bear Scat, Michigan and Saskatchewan, Canada, and as part of the New World Order, North American Union takeover, the combination of everything. So anyway, yeah, but the thing that you missed out on Monday morning, and this started last year, on Monday morning we have like a community breakfast. So people that have leftover bacon, potatoes, sausage, whatever, they'll bring it over and I will cook it up and make breakfast for everybody still there. And a couple people jump in and help out, I think you met Rick and Melissa. Rick helped with cutting up potatoes because that's an awful lot of potatoes. Mm-hmm. My hippies were helping me out with little things here and there. So I made up scrambled eggs with bacon, with diced bacon inside of it. A sausage hash, and it's diced potatoes with fresh cut green peppers, onions, and pork sausage mixed into it, along with some extra spices and everything. So it's the concept of corned beef hash, but it's using breakfast sausage. And of course, I whipped up about at least 6 pounds of bacon. It was 6 pounds of bacon if it was an ounce.
That's quite a bit of bacon. A bit of bacon.
Well, we have this thing, it's called practice bacon, and because you can't cook 6 pounds of bacon all at one time, even though I use a wok with a lot of bacon grease to deep fry it. So I'll whip up a couple pounds at a time, put it out there, and serve it as appetizer, as hors d'oeuvres. So you remember as a kid getting your knuckles swatted for grabbing bacon before the meal was ready?
Yep.
Yeah, well, the anarchist solution to that is make up a whole lot of extra bacon and call it practice bacon.
Ah, I like that. I like that.
Yeah. So, but here's what's really neat. Of people that contributed to the breakfast, one guy, Jeff, he was out there for the day, I believe, on Saturday and maybe Sunday. I'm not sure if he's out there on Sunday. But he contributed like 2 pounds of this super thick cut. I can't even call it bacon. It's like bacon steaks. But he went to the butcher shop and he bought this really fancy stuff, top notch, top of the line. Said, hey, I can't be here for it, but here's my contribution to Monday morning breakfast. I'm like, awesome. Wow, that's awful nice. And then I think you met Katie. She's one of the dog owners there, but half the place had dogs with them. She's a vegetarian, and because bacon was an integral part of every meal, because I cook her every part of it, everything was cooked in bacon grease. But she's a vegetarian, but she, threw in a couple bags of potatoes anyway. So, even people that weren't participating in eating voluntarily contributed and took part in this whole thing.
Awesome. Awesome. Lots of generosity, it seems. Lots of generosity. And for the listeners of Liberty Under Attack Radio, that's probably the longest conversation we'll have about food. But it was an integral part in the Liberty Festival. It definitely was.
If that's your longest conversation that you'll have about food, you need to try a lot harder.
I know. It just never seems to come up, unfortunately. I'm not quite sure why.
I could talk the first segment about food.
All right. Well, since we're on food already, the Lousander Spooner's Assault Kitchen. There was a
Lousander Feen's Assault Lousander Kitchen.
Feen's, yeah. Well, I apologize. Didn't mean to misname that. But there was a certain certainly interesting license. It was the first time I've seen it when I was at the festival. It was called like a BIPCOT no-gov license. What does that entail?
Yes, the BIPCOT no-government license is like Creative Commons, but it can't be called Creative Commons because Creative Commons includes everybody. So the BIPCOT no-government license excludes government, their agents, and their thugs. So as an example, when we do the Freedom Feens radio show or when I'm talking about the Assault Kitchen, I would say this Assault Kitchen is covered by a BIPCOT no-government license. This allows use and reuse by anyone except for government. Learn more at BIPCOT.org.
Okay, awesome. Awesome. So how did that get started? Like, who started that? Because before I saw it at the festival, I've never heard of that before.
I'm pretty sure that's Michael Dean's brainchild. Because the Freedom Feens has always been Creative Commons, and he wanted to do something and then exclude government. Now, there are no legal ramifications for government thugs using and reusing, except for shaming. So nobody gets dragged into court. There's no hit squads. They're just publicly shamed as using without permission.
Okay. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. I guess let's move forward. How did you enjoy the festival overall? How many years have you gone to the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest?
Well, I'm 3 for 3 on the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, and I really, really enjoyed it. The first one, I would have to say that I was absolutely giddy and euphoric because the first one was my first actual Liberty event. When you look at the Midwest Peace of Liberty Fest, one of the neat things about it is back in February of maybe 2012, I think it was, some people were sitting around on a cold, snowy Michigan morning and saying, hey, you know what? We should go camping this year. And eventually the conversation went along with, well, hey, let's get a bunch of people to go camping this year and let's have like a Liberty Fest type theme to it. And that was the birth of the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. And the first one was probably about half to two thirds the number of people that were at the last one. And most of us knew each other, but we did have some people come over from out of state that I'd never met before and were new to the group, the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition. And incidentally, mm-hmm. hearing about the fest was how I heard about the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition, which we'll get into shortly. But that was when I first met Ben Stone for the first time. So he was somebody that I had communicated with over email and had been listening to the podcast and everything, and got a chance to meet him and sit down and shoot the bull with him. Also, Stephanie Murphy and Brian Sovereign came out from New Hampshire, and Stephanie was at this Liberty Fest.
Yep, she was.
She taught the yoga class, but I opted for bacon instead. And we had a lot of people from all over the place. We had people from Kentucky. We had people from New York State, and it was all these people that are they know each other because of FaceBeast or other social networks, but maybe haven't met in person. Mm-hmm. So that was great. And then that was at a state forest campground, and that wasn't really that great because we had the goons coming in and scrutinizing everything and squinting at everybody, making sure that they're in compliance with all the laws, rules, regulations, ordinances, codes, policies, and everything else. But last year we found Circle Pines, and Circle Pines is a nice little place. They're a bit on the lefty side, and they're like on the lefty status side too. But they're friendly to us, I guess would be the way to put it, or at least they tolerate us, or they like our money, whatever. But they have been gracious hosts. But we went out there, and the second fest got a little bit bigger, and we had people come from as far south as Georgia, I think it was.
Oh wow!
I don't know if there's anybody from Florida, but I came from as I think Randy came from Randy England was the furthest away because he came from Jefferson City, Missouri. As far east, I think New York State was the furthest. But anyway, so yeah, we had a lot of people coming from all over the place. As a matter of fact, last year Will Coley was there. You didn't get a chance to meet him this year
because
he wasn't able to make it up. But you know who he is, right?
Yep, I've seen him around. Yep.
Okay, all right. He's for those that don't know who Will Coley is, he is the national director for Muslims for Liberty, and he is bringing libertarianism to Islam, but he's also trying to beat down the goofiness about Islam is a bunch of devil worshippers and all that other crap, all the stuff that the Christian Sharia folks are complaining about. But yeah. Anyway, so really nice guy, and he is an excellent cook. I don't know if I'd put myself up against him.
That good,
if I did, I might have somebody put some money on him for me.
there you go.
So like at Pork Fest, he was selling meals when I was there 2 years ago, and that's where I met him the first time. He was selling meals at Pork Fest during the week, and then when Ramadan started, he was giving away meals free in the evening time at sunset to break the fast, and he served a couple hundred meals.
Wow.
And he also sold meals at the Liberty Fest last year for Friday, Saturday, Sunday afternoon, and then Sunday evening he gave them away. And he collects donations for taking his show on the road to different festivals and different activities and events. And he does pretty good with collecting the donations. Not bad for a bunch of greedy libertarians that hate poor people.
Who will help the poor?
Yeah.
But that's always an interesting question.
Yeah.
And the fact that that's usually one of the first questions that's asked shows that we really don't have to worry about feeding the poor.
Yeah. Well, really, and I don't want to jump ahead just yet, but when somebody says, but what about the poor? My first response is, well, how do they have it now under statism? The fact that we're having this conversation means that the state hasn't solved this problem. And if you're opposition to anarchy is that, well, how's anarchy going to solve a problem that the state hasn't solved and most likely caused? So, but anyway, but yeah, getting back to Liberty Fest, it's a really neat event. It's small. It's under a couple hundred people currently. Who knows? It might grow. I almost don't want to see it get too big because I like the intimacy that you have. I think I got a chance to talk to darn near everybody there. Actually sit down and shoot the bull with them. At the very least, I got a chance to say hello to everybody that was there. And maybe exchange some pleasantries. But it's a very intimate environment. It is, There's plenty of activities going on. There's presentations going on. And it's not like going to Porkfest where you have all these celebritarians doing their presentations and you know, trying to get you to buy land down at their project or, you know, all this other stuff. It's people talk about the things that they do or things that they want to see. And, you know, a lot of times it just turns into a discussion. So, I mean, that's really neat, but I really don't get to the presentations either at Porkfest or at Liberty Fest because I spend most of my time cooking or just goofing off, shooting the bull with people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, the Assault Kitchen was almost a presentation of its own because I had a table and chairs set up out there and people were sitting around shooting the bull. Sometimes I was there, sometimes I wasn't. But I tell you what, had there been somebody besides the NSA listening in and recording that, oh, that would make one hell of a podcast.
Yeah, I know the first day I got there, Saturday, it was probably Saturday morning, I went over there and just hung out and I mentioned this in my article, but like I didn't really know what to expect. I'd never been to a Liberty Festival. I didn't know if I was going to get here and it was going to be like a lot of minarchists or a lot of anarchists. I didn't really know what to expect. And I went over there and I sat down. I didn't sit down. I just stood around. And the first discussions I heard were on Bitcoin and Austrian economics. So that was definitely, I was like, yeah, you know, I think I'm in the right place.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think that I could really slap a label on it. About the best description I could give would be liberty-themed camping event. There might be the occasional mini-status running around somewhere. I don't think we've seen any of them since last year. You know, nobody's going, yeah, Rand Paul's going to, you know, save the country because, you know, the state's not the problem if Rand Paul is the solution. But anyway, so, and yeah, it's a camping trip because you got the lake down there. I don't know if you made it down to the lake and use the canoes.
Which I did not.
Okay. Yeah, they got a lake down there. There's a nice little raft that you can swim out to. I took the fly rod out and I caught a couple of smallmouth bass and the kids got a kick out of that. And, I mean, they're just tiny little bass, but the kids got a kick out of it. But they had canoes that you could take out and there was no charge for that. That was included in the weekend. There's a little sauna room down there, a little fire pit there at the beach. But I mean, there was just so many different things that people could do. You know, mm-hmm. whether it's going to the presentations or just, you know, going hiking, because I mean, there's just plenty of trails around there. So,
yeah, and I was definitely surprised. We own property in southern Illinois, and I actually lived in Michigan a few years ago, but it was Lansing, if you know where that is. Yes. But I'd never been to kind of like the country in Michigan. It's uniquely different than the country in Illinois. And it was just truly beautiful. The Circle Pond Center was definitely was. So,
yeah, Lansing is the state capital of Michigan. So that's Mordor on the Grand River.
Yeah, I lived there from how old was I? I think I lived there from like kindergarten to like second grade or something like that. It was just a few years. But yeah, I didn't really have any memories from there. Yeah, it was nice to get out into the country of Michigan.
Yeah. Well, one of the things about Michigan, once you get outside like the metro areas or along the highways, once you're off of I-94, because even if you get out to the Kalamazoo area where Circle Pines is, it's rural, but it still has that big city. Once you get into different places in rural Michigan and you get a chance to see the country, it's probably one of the more beautiful tax farms out there.
Yeah,
and when you get to the Upper Peninsula where I live, I mean, that is just absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah, I think I've been through. When we were heading up to Canada a couple of years ago, I think we went over the. I don't remember what that is. It the Mackinac Bridge up to Upper Peninsula. Is that the right name?
Okay. Yeah. So yeah, that's at the top of the Mitten. But all right. So you only saw a tiny bit of it because like the Upper Peninsula is huge.
Yeah, just to get into Canada.
Yeah, so you went up to Sault Ste. Marie, but mm-hmm. and yeah, I had company up this weekend. A buddy of mine from downstate lifelong friends. We've known each other, gosh, 30 years if it's been a day. And he brought his 7-year-old son up here. And I took them out yesterday morning to do a little bit of sightseeing. Well, we were going up to Walmart to buy a fishing license, but that took like 3 or 4 hours because we stopped off and I showed him like the natural spring that's on the side of the road, artesian well, so you could go fill up your water buckets and stuff like that. We stopped by a waterfall that's right on the side of the road. There's a little pull off to park and picnic and all this other stuff, you know. And you should have seen his, son's face. I forget his eyes being as big as saucers. They were as big as dinner plates when he saw that thing for the first time. I wish I would have had a camera to take that picture. Yeah. And then we went over to another park. Well, we went down through Wisconsin to come back up to Michigan, but we went through this little park and, you know, there's whitewater rapids down there, and it's just really awesome stuff. So they loved it.
Awesome. Well, we are heading out to our first break. Stay tuned. We'll get more into the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, voluntarism, and a couple of other things right around the corner. Stay tuned. Got your fears filled up in lights. See your hand.
This is Niz from Disassociation Nation. As many of you know, I'm an avid vapor. And if you're like me, you're tired of being charged ridiculous amounts of cash for a disappointing experience when flavors just don't deliver. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to Vapor Renew, a Flavor West company. If you're into mixing and creating your own custom e-liquids, Flavor West has everything you need to make delicious, satisfying flavors. Doesn't matter if you're a flavor chaser or if you love the look and feel of those big, beautiful puffy plumes. FlavorWest.com can provide you with everything you need. Let's face it, if you vape, e-liquid is an ongoing expense. And if you're a dripper like me, then you know that blowing through a $30 bottle of juice isn't unheard of. Why pay more than you have to? So for excellent quality juice made right here in the United States, head over to VaporRenew.com, where they have hundreds of flavors pre-mixed and ready to vape at the most reasonable prices you'll find. Use coupon code RENU for an extra 10% off your entire order. Great juice at a great price and 10% off. Support companies that support liberty by making your next purchase at VaporRenew. Or for mixing supplies, don't forget FlavorWest.com.
doTERRA essential oils, true gifts of the earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the family physician kit. 10 certified pure therapeutic grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit essentialnewparadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you.
Do you have a group or organization founded on the principles of personal liberty, health, freedom, or accountable government? We invite you to check out Same Side Entertainment. Get connected with leaders in the liberty movement like Tom Woods, Kevin Gutzman, Jack Hunter, Robert Scott Bell, Michael Scheuer, and many more. Find us on Facebook, Twitter, and our website at www.samesideentertainment.com. Again, that's www.samesideentertainment.com. Same Side Entertainment, connecting you with the education and resources you need.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.
Can somebody get me a goddamn lighter that wasn't made in China? Jeez. Yes, Katie.
Mr. President?
What is it?
Mr. Emanuel.
Put him through. Hey, Rambo.
Barry.
Good morning.
I just got off the phone with David. He said he faxed you a copy of your next speech.
Lovely.
Katie should have it.
Okay.
Briefly.
Absolutely.
Try to get it right this time.
Will do, Rob.
Okay, I'll talk to you.
Thank you.
And welcome back to the Under Attack Radio here on the Freedom Feens Radio Network. If you're just tuning in, I'm here with Lou Feen from Freedom Feens Radio. If I could say that, that'd be nice. If you got anything to add to the conversation or you got a question for Lou, feel free to give us a call. The number is 218-895-3818 or on Skype at FPRN Radio Live. So before we went to break, Lou, we were talking about the scenery up in Michigan, all of the features that you witnessed. Was it just this past weekend? So I guess let's kind of continue with that a little bit more. So, first off, what events did you attend when you were at the festival there and at the Circle Pond Center?
The only presentation that I went to was Adam Kokesh's speech, and I got a nice little interview with him afterwards, which will be airing on Saturday the 23rd on the Freedom Feens radio show. So the podcast will be that'll be up mid-afternoon, so people will be able to get that. Or if they want to listen live, they could go to lrn.fm or gcnlive.com. But anyway, so yeah, that turned out pretty good. It was really nice to talk to Adam, and I asked him some questions that he typically doesn't get, at least not in the interviews that I've seen him do. So just to tease it out a little bit, it's going to be worth a while.
Awesome. That was my next question. When can we expect to hear that interview? And I was considering getting an interview with Adam, but I don't know. They had to be in Detroit, I think, in just a couple of hours after he spoke. So they were in a little bit of a rush, but they were kind enough to get like to stick around, get all the pictures taken, autographs of the books, and things like that.
As I was putting my equipment away, he was strapping everything down to get ready to move.
That quick.
So,
huh?
Yeah. So, I got like just a few seconds under 30 minutes with him, and I was probably lucky to get that.
Oh, so you got almost a full 30 minutes then.
Yeah.
For an interview. Awesome. Good deal. And that'll be on lrn.fm or gcnlive.com. Is that correct?
Yeah.
It's coming Saturday. Awesome.
Yeah. At 1 p.m. Eastern time, or go to freedomfiends.com mid-afternoon. The podcast of the show will be posted.
Awesome.
So it's going to be me and Ben talking about the interview and talking about Liberty Fest. So you'll hear a little bit more about Liberty Fest.
Good deal. And that would be Ben Stone, correct?
Yeah. Ben Stone, the Bad Quaker.
Good deal. Yeah. And I actually got a chance to tune into his last one was with Cody Wilson. And I do enjoy Cody Wilson quite a bit. So I listened to that interview. He seems like a very, very intelligent person. And I think I've heard him a couple times on The Feens as well. So, yeah, I'm glad you turned me on to him too.
Cody Wilson is very interesting. I don't know that I've ever talked to him on the show. Maybe I don't know. But one thing I gotta say about Cody is with his ghost gunner and with his 3D printer, and it's amazing all the pro Second Amendment conservatards that are supporting or are opposed to him and are like, oh my God, he's disruptive, he's dangerous, all this other stuff. Let me tell you guys something. Cody Wilson with his ghost gunner, which is a CNC machine that will do an 80% load or lower for a fraction of the cost of the heavy duty machines, Cody Wilson will do more to preserve gun rights than the NRA, the Second Amendment, and a bunch of flag worshippers marching around a politician's office waving his flag at him really hard.
Yep, I definitely agree. I kind of took an interest in Cody. I knew when he printed that firearm, but he seems like a really interesting dude, and I love watching him be interviewed because he's extremely intelligent.
Yeah. But going back to the conservatards, they care more about the Second Amendment than they do gun ownership. Think about
that. That's kind of how it seems.
It's parchment worship. That's all it is. You can take away my gun rights just as long as I can keep my Second Amendment. Really?
So what's the point of the Second Amendment then?
Parchment worship, basically.
Yep, true.
But anyway, back to the happier stuff, the Liberty Fest in Northern Michigan. So anyway, as I mentioned before, I had a company up here from downstate, and he was going to be in Northern Mitten. His family has property there, so he was coming over to see me, check out the new place and everything. And so I decided, we were talking, and said, hey, you want to go camping tonight? We'll head east an hour or two, and they'll put you a little bit closer to your destination, and plus go out and do some fishing. So we grabbed the boat and went out and did some fishing on Lake Michigan, caught some walleye, caught a few rock bass. I caught a little pike. So his 7-year-old son, it has to be absolutely stoked. But, when I was talking to the kid earlier today, he said, what do you like most about this weekend? He's like, playing at the playground in the park at the campground. And I'm like, really?
Come on.
Fair enough. Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah, well, I, you know, 7 year olds, but I, yeah, he had a blast with all that other stuff, and that's one of the things, you know, going back to my introduction, which I haven't really done. I love the outdoor stuff. I love camping. I love hiking, fishing, hunting, watching the wind blow. You know, just really goofing off, and Michigan has an environment to where you can do those things.
Mm-hmm. Yep, indeed it does. Indeed it does. So let's get back to the festival. If I remember correctly, which I think I hope I do, on Saturday evening, it was in one of the open presentation times. I remember you getting up and having a friendly debate with a gentleman. I think it was some guy that worked there. I think it was about capitalism.
Yes.
Can you kind of tell us a little bit about that?
Okay. Yeah, the guy's name's Patrick. I believe he's a Freedom Feens listener, too. But, yeah, he fits in with the crowd there. In having like some lefty tendencies, but he's a no government guy. He's a anarchist, voluntarist, you know, whatever you want to call it, but definitely of the left persuasion. So and he's also a conspiracy kook. But anyway, his thing was, you know, he believes in voluntary interactions. And when you look at capitalism, I mean, free market capitalism, not this state sponsored corporatism, crony capitalism, whatever you want to call it. That stuff is not capitalism. So in many regards, it's arguing over the definitions of things. So if you look at – oh, and he also has a problem with private property and money. But anyway, so if you take out the fact that crony capitalism exists because politicians have favors to sell – plain and simple. The power to regulate is the power to grant favors. Yep. So when you look at I believe I've heard that Walmart has lobbied for higher minimum wage. And, you know, people will say, well, why would they lobby for a higher minimum wage? Why can't they just give the minimum wage themselves? Well, if it's a mandate, that means that a small mom and pop place is going to have to pay more money and doesn't have all the money that a Walmart has. A Walmart is an organization that can absorb regulations and mandates a lot better than a small mom and pop. It's like me going up against Bill Gates. Now, also, I don't want to bash Walmart. I love Walmart. I think they do an awesome service, and I think they would be just as good without the state.
Yeah, and it's a way to either buy out competition or put the competition out of business.
Yeah, and you cripple them because there is a cost of compliance with all these different mandates. So where, you know, like the lefties say, oh, yeah, minimum wage, my feels, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions.
Mm-hmm.
And when you look at these smaller businesses, those are the ones that are going to hurt a lot more than a McDonald's, a Walmart, or any big corporation. But they're just so wedded to the ideology that they won't let reality get in the way.
Yep. So I also remember correctly about this little friendly debate with you said his name was Patrick.
Yeah.
It seemed like from watching that. I mean, he had some he conceded to quite a few of your arguments. So I think kind of what I saw happening was. Maybe just confusion on the terms. Maybe he's taking, I don't know, like the commie definition of capitalism, things like that. He kind of sounds like a zeitgeister a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. I'm pretty sure it's not a conspiracy theory that he ever met that he didn't like. You know, and he's even a self-avowed conspiracy kook. But anyway, I guess just the clarification of the meanings because, you know, what's more voluntary than a transaction? As an example, you know, I had lots of breakfast on Saturday morning for sale. Even though I wasn't planning on vending, I always make extra. And I know there's people who are going to come by and say, hey, you got any extra food? Because they didn't bring any food or they don't feel like cooking. But anyway, so they've got some Bitcoin, some silver, some Federal Reserve notes. And I have some, you know, breakfast. I got like a bunch of bacon and some hash browns and eggs and stuff like that. And they say, hey, you know, I'd really like some of that breakfast. And I'm like, well, I'd really like some of that Bitcoin. And, you know, we, we exchange and everybody's happy. We don't need a meddling third party. We don't need Agent Smith from the Matrix to come right in and say, you know, stop right there. I have to get a piece of this action. So,
yeah, indeed. And it was, and since you brought that up, I was one of the ones that did not bring food. I think I survived the entire weekend on like beef jerky sticks and peanuts, unfortunately. But hey, made it through. And I think next year they're going to try to get some more people vending, which would be a good thing.
Yeah, the vending was not really as well coordinated as it was last year. Also, I don't think there were a lot of people that were as interested in vending. I had absolutely no intention of vending. I figured that I would cook some meals like for Diana and Christian and Randy while they're there, you know, maybe make a dinner or two. But I had no idea that I was going to wind up doing as much as I did.
Gotcha.
So,
awesome.
But anyway, going back to Patrick, the discussion was on private property and money. As far as money goes, money is simply a tool. It's no more evil than a hammer, a wrench, a screwdriver, or anything like that, or a tape measure. I mean, it's just quite simply a tool. It depends on how it's used. So when you have like a central bank or a government controlling the money and devaluing it and using it for political benefits or to benefit the politically connected, yeah, there's a problem with money. But, you know, money itself is not a problem.
Yeah.
And ultimately, the solution to that is to get the state out of the money. Yep. I mean, that's just a Cliff Notes Theater version of what I said. And I know it was recorded, but I don't think that has been uploaded to YouTube yet.
Oh, it was recorded?
Yeah. Yeah.
Awesome.
I'm kind of curious to see what I said or to hear what I said.
Yeah, and see, that's why I was kind of kicking myself that I missed some of the conversation. But yeah, hopefully that goes up here soon. I'd like to check that out again. So I guess let's kind of move forward and go into we mentioned Kokesh's presentation. How'd you enjoy it? What'd you think of it?
I thought it was pretty good. I think he really nailed on some of the aspects of the libertarian anarchist community, the peaceful mm-hmm. parenting, the nonviolent communication. I have problems with nonviolent communication because, and as it is, it could be very manipulative, and it's a lot of feels based stuff, which yeah. I'm not completely opposed to, but it's all based upon feels, from what I've seen of it. But anyway, I just prefer honest, effective communications, and the whole NVC thing comes off kind of culty to me.
Yeah, and I mean, I for those who haven't read it yet on libertarianattack.com, my write up it is pretty long, but I do kind of discuss that a little bit. But kind of, I guess kind of my viewpoint on it is I don't think I'm kind of neutral on it. I just think most communication is already like most communication is nonviolent as it is, unless you're trying to invoke someone to do something or if you're making threats. I think communication overall is pretty peaceful, as it is. So
let me jump in and make a little clarification. I believe it was listed as nonviolent compassionate communication.
Correct. Yep. Correct.
Yeah. So anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, for Kokesh's, I thought he's a great speaker. He definitely is. He's a great speaker. And I was kind of surprised. I've watched a couple of his American Campfire Freedom Tour speeches, and it looks like they vary a little bit from place to place. I guess I did enjoy his speech. I'm just not sure. I guess we can go into this next subject here. I'm just not sure what I feel about an anarchist politician. Not sure how I feel about that.
That falls along the lines of Christian atheist. Yeah, I don't see that as a really viable thing. If you're an anarchist and it's based upon principle, I can't see trying to become the state to disassemble the state.
Yeah, Yep, I agree, and I've written extensively on this subject. I mean, one of the guys up in Free Keen, I remember Ian Bernard was like, "We have an anarchist politician." It's like there's no such thing.
Yeah, that's Ian Freeman, and he's the host and co-creator of Free Talk Live.
Yep, he is. Yeah, I don't know. I just I feel like as an anarchist, voluntarist, whatever flavor or stripe.
Abolitionist
in general. I'll just call it abolitionist in general. I feel like running or voting or anything like that is kind of only furthering the superstition and giving people faith that the political means can still be effective, which Albert J. Nock mentioned in his book, Our Enemy of the State. We have the economic means and the political means, and the political means have proven to be failures. Paraphrased a little bit, but...
Yeah, well, going back to something I said earlier, if Rand Paul is the solution, then the state isn't really the problem. And everything that, you know, the anarchist Rand supporters have said about the state is wrong. So, there's so many different directions to go with it. If somebody asked me, well, how did you become an anarchist? Well, I found the state to be intolerable. And it wasn't just, you know... The presidents of my lifetime, the Nixons, the Carters, Clintons, Bushes, Obamas, Reagan. Now, if you go back through history, it's been a viper's den. And George Washington, and I want to plug the Dangerous History podcast here at profcj.org. He's really torn George Washington apart and pointed out that most of the mythology that we learn about George Washington and the rest of the presidents in the government indoctrination gulags, it is just that. It's mythology. It's the Church of Lincoln. It's the Church of Washington. Mm-hmm. He wasn't a good guy. He wasn't particularly brilliant. He was a lousy general. The only reason he was never killed in battle was because the British couldn't attack faster than he could retreat. He only won like three battles. He spent his military career getting beat. As a matter of fact, he was even denied a commission in the British military. So he was denied a commission to become a redcoat. Now, where do you think he would have fallen had he received that commission?
On the other side.
Yeah. And it probably would have been better for the colonists. But I mean, his money, most of it came from inheritance, or a lot of it came from inheritance, and then building it up was dependent upon the state getting special benefits, getting land grants, getting special privileges. And he really didn't accomplish a whole heck of a lot. But when you hear the traditional narrative, he's this great man, this once in a lifetime figure that comes along with special capabilities and powers, and that doesn't exist. I mean, Herbert Spencer destroyed the myth of the great man back in the 1800s.
Yeah, that's true, and it's definitely mythology. As Larkin Rose put it, statism is a religion to some of these folks.
That's exactly what it is, and is the religion that justifies and legitimizes the existence of governments and states. Yeah. Now, I like with Christianity, you have a single Messiah that will come along at an unknown time and change the world and bring paradise. Now, with statism, you have multiple messiahs that come along in series of 2, 4, and 6 years.
Yep, that's true. That's a good way of putting it.
And they've all turned out to be false messiahs.
Yep, that is true. And it's turned this geographical country on a map. It's turned it into a shithole, into tax farms, and it's murdered far too many people throughout history, and it's not going to stop until all the state is abolished.
Well, here's some things to think about. And in the 20th century alone, we know that the state is responsible for 263 million murders outside of war.
Mm-hmm.
That's 263 murders of their own citizens. That's over a quarter of a billion people. And it's not just one country. It wasn't just Nazi Germany or the Soviet Union that did that. That happened in multiple countries. Now, and as far as the genocide goes, the U.S. was pretty light in the 20th century domestically. But if you look at the 17, 1800s, you know, that's when they were really going. But when you have this happening, and this has gone on all through history, the state is second only to disease-spreading insects as far as cause of unnatural death. Because this has been going on for all these centuries, you know, for the 10,000 years that the state has actually existed, and because it's been infinitely replicable, you know, the state is doing what the only thing that it can do. It's the only thing that it can be. It can never be good. It can never be benevolent. It can never be kind, loving, and compassionate. It is always a violent slave circle or slave ring.
Yeah, that is true. And I'm glad you brought up that statistic, the 263 million people murdered by government in the 20th century. I think that's a number that needs to be kind of spread around a little more, although I'm not sure if that alone will shake some of these status out of their delusion.
Well, I bring that up to people, and they will have a tendency to just clam up. And something else to point out about that, about the 20th century, the technology to kill was a fraction of what it is today. And the nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons of the 20th century, particularly the early 20th century when they were mostly used, was very crude and primitive. Now, when you look at the biological organisms that can be put out there, I mean, it's unbelievable. If you look at the heck, I don't even know if they even had bombers or planes in World War One. You know, and I think they're flying around in little biplanes and shooting at each other with their pistols and throwing hand grenades at each other. And they didn't really have a whole lot, but you know, World War Two, it advanced and eventually you had rockets and now guided missiles and now you predator drones and all this other stuff. I mean, the state is just it's absolutely armed to the teeth. And as far as capability of committing murder and genocide, you know, right now it's peak government. It's at its peak of all time history.
Yeah, indeed.
I mean, there used to be a time where the politicians would have to actually send people out to find somebody. They'd have to track them down and then physically kill them with a sword or maybe even a pistol. But now it's like nobody has to leave the office anymore.
Yeah, that is true. They have a much higher ability to inflict damage, definitely, with that technology.
In particularly with the surveillance and the spy state. So, I mean, it's, you know, it's really difficult to escape that unless you want to go all Unabomber and run around the woods in a loincloth.
good point.
Which may or may not have happened at Liberty Fest. No, I'm kidding. I don't think it happens.
I don't think so, but I mean, it wouldn't surprise me too much.
but there is one possibility. When we look at the 10,000 year history of the state, and that's about how long the first evidence of a state goes back to. That's what the evidence shows. I mean, there could be something older, but anyway, I will not exclude the possibility that just over the past 10,000 years, every society has, you know, just gotten it wrong and elected the wrong people. Because who knows? Maybe that's what happened. You know, maybe there is that benevolent person out there that can wear the ring and not turn into Smeagol.
Yeah. Who knows?
That was sarcasm.
I know. Yeah, I think that's I think the empirical evidence kind of debunks that. Anybody who gets into the seat of power like that, if they aren't corrupted, they're completely useless. Like Ron Paul, he didn't really do anything bad, but they just kind of railroaded him in the in Congress. Like, he never got to do anything good. So
well, he never really had any real power.
True.
And ultimately, now he was chairman of the House Banking Committee, and maybe his, you know, and this is a little conspiratorial, but it's not entirely unrealistic. You know, maybe the party bosses said, you know what, you've earned a spot as a chair of this committee, and you know what, we think that you should be able to spout off a little bit, just a little. Don't push the line. Because if you do, then, you know, maybe things won't go so nice. Maybe something will happen. You're an old guy. Nobody would suspect anything.
Yeah. Yeah, many things possible.
I'm not saying that happened, but it's not entirely outside the realm of possibility. So when you look at the fact that he, you know, his 30 years off and on in Congress, and he accomplished absolutely zero for liberty through the legislative means, you know, I'd say that, you know, he really had no power. He may have had more of an interest than everybody else, but he had absolutely zero impact.
Yeah. Yeah, that is definitely true. We are coming up to the second break here. When we come back, I would like to get into a little more of the festival, kind of discuss some of the other presentations that went on there. And also, hopefully hear from some of you, the listeners, if you've got something to bring up for Lou. Got a question for him? Feel free to give us a call when we come back, 218-895-3818, or on Skype at FPRN Radio Live. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Hello, America. You believe in liberty? Well, fuck you! Why is it that every time I turn on internet radio, I can't seem to find one educated person with libertarian point of views? That's why I choose FPR and radio! For liberty, goddammit!
doTERRA Essential Oils, True Gifts of the Earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the Family Physician Kit. 10 certified pure, therapeutic-grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit EssentialNewParadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you. Health depends on you.
This is Niz from Disassociation Nation. As many of you know, I'm an avid vapor. And if you're like me, you're tired of being charged ridiculous amounts of cash for a disappointing experience when flavors just don't deliver. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to Vapor Renew, a Flavor West company. If you're into mixing and creating your own custom e-liquids, Flavor West has everything you need to make delicious, satisfying flavors. It doesn't matter if you're a flavor chaser or if you love the look and feel of those big, beautiful puffy plumes. FlavorWest.com can provide you with everything you need. Let's face it, if you vape, e-liquid is an ongoing expense. And if you're a dripper like me, then you know that blowing through a $30 bottle of juice isn't unheard of. Why pay more than you have to? So for excellent quality juice made right here in the United States, head over to VaporRenew.com, where they have hundreds of flavors pre-mixed and ready to vape at the most reasonable prices you'll find. Use coupon code RENU for an extra 10% off your entire order. Great juice at a great price and 10% off. Support companies that support liberty by making your next purchase at VaporRenew. Or for mixing supplies, don't forget FlavorWest.com.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us, or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.
Corporations, Wall Street and the banks rule our politicians. They don't deserve our thanks, then they tell us.
And welcome back to Liberty Under Attack Radio. We've just crossed into the second final hour of the show for this evening. And if you're just joining us, I'm here with good friend Lou Feen from Freedom Feens Radio. And we're discussing a whole lot of different things here. Probably the most predominant topic is the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, and that's kind of what I'd like to get back into a little bit here. Lou, the Midwest Peace and Liberty it's a Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition were the ones who organized this event. Can you give us some information on them? And the reason I ask is I am considering after that festival and meeting all of the people and seeing all the stuff that all of the things these people are doing in Michigan, I'd want to be around people like that. So I'm going to wait until next next year's festival to kind of see if I'm still feeling that way. Yeah, can you give us some information on the Midwest Peace and Liberty Coalition, or Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition? I apologize.
Well, yeah, it's a decentralized group. It's a bunch of people that believe in voluntarism, anarchism, abolitionism. You know, hey, what? I'm opposed to all sorts of slavery. What type do you support? But anyway, yeah, and it's just a bunch of people that like to get together. We have shared values as far as the zero aggression principle and treating each other properly with respect, respect for property. And we get together quite frequently on social basis, but we also get together for different activities. There has been some outreach to the general public on the theory of voluntarism and self-ownership. What else? We did a anti-Syria invasion protest in downtown Detroit at the Jazz Fest a couple of years ago. We don't do any flag waving, you know, because it doesn't matter how hard you wave the flag, government's going to do what it wants to do. But what we did is more than just an anti-war protest. It was an outreach to the regular people down there about freedom, liberty, not using aggression to get what you want, and then also just pointing out what a farce the empire is.
There's
Bitcoin events that are related to the group. The group itself doesn't do Bitcoin events, but we're involved with like Michigan Bitcoiners. Mm-hmm. and there's been outreach at the Makers Fair, I believe it's called, at the Henry Ford Museum. What's his name? Antonopoulos. Andreas Antonopoulos was out there. So a couple of our people met him, and they've communicated with him quite a bit over the past year or so. A lot of outreach, a lot of education, all kinds of neat stuff.
Yeah, indeed. And it was, I know one of the, I'm not sure if she's a member of the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition, but another thing I really loved from the festival, like even where I'm at now, I would like to join the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition at some point when I move there. But for the time being, there's a woman from Northwest Indiana, and she unschools her children, and she's going to come to Springfield, which is about an hour right in between of each of us. So we're going to meet up and maybe get something going since I can't be in Michigan now. Meet up and kind of get a meetup group going and see if we can pull something together here in the communist state of Illinois and Indiana.
You're talking about Amanda, right?
Correct.
Okay. To give you the to give you an idea, and to give the listeners an idea of the impact of shows like yours, she had never heard of the Michigan Peace of Liberty Coalition or Midwest Peace of Liberty Fest prior to my appearance on the Seeds of Liberty podcast. I think you might be familiar with those guys, right?
Yep, I actually saw your interview with them, yeah.
Okay, so anyway, I went on there, did an interview, and I was talking about the Liberty Fest, and she was interested because she lives in the vicinity, and she wound up coming out, and she's probably going to get involved and come to some events out in the Detroit area, or maybe if there's something going on the west side of the state, like in Kalamazoo, because we have a few people out in that area. And as a matter of fact, I think they have a meetup scheduled pretty soon. But stuff like this, the social media, the different Liberty radio shows and podcasts are a great way of connecting with other people and spreading the message.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And I mean, additionally, I think it was from one of the guys there who does a lot of traveling through the Midwest. Apparently, there are two, voluntarism groups up in Chicago, which in Naperville, I think, which I was unaware of completely. I did a little digging to see if I could find them, but unfortunately, the syndicalist groups, anarcho-communists, they make themselves pretty well known that they're getting together and having a bookstore and stuff like that. But unfortunately, the voluntarism groups are a little harder to find. I'm not sure why that is, but there's other groups I might be able to attend if I can find them. So definitely these festivals are huge for things like that. Because, I mean, it's really easy to feel isolated with no one and no one in your town that that is like-minded or anything like that. But going to these festivals kind of opens up your your line of communication to a lot of people that share the same principles that you do.
Well, one of the things, I mean, being in the People's Republic of Illinois, as you are, how often do you run into somebody that shares our values or your values for that matter?
I mean, they're definitely not voluntarists. They like working inside the system and things, but share the same principles to an extent. But they haven't jumped the minarchist ship altogether. Okay, so I guess, yeah, not necessarily very many people at all. Maybe one or two.
Okay, so they're liberty-ish.
They're libertarian leaning.
Yeah. Okay. So, when you have something like this and you can get together with people that, you know, think the same way that you do and you have that much in common, I mean, it's really amazing. You know, like I said, when I went to First Liberty Fest, I was absolutely euphoric. I had found it by scrolling through Facebook and somebody had shared the event and I'm like, hey, wow, this looks pretty neat. And I clicked, you know, yes, that I would go because this was probably, oh gosh, maybe springtime, something like that was posted. So anyway, I clicked yes on it and threw in, hey, yeah, I'm really excited and interested about this. Can't wait. Immediately thereafter, I get a couple friend requests, and shortly thereafter was when I went to my first meetup. And if you remember, Ann, one of the guys on the Bitcoin panel, he was doing a presentation on Bitcoin at the time, and I'd heard about it, but I didn't know much, you know, didn't really know much about it. But at that time, I was so isolated because I'd never met a real voluntarist in real life. You know, it was kind of like, you know, these people that exist on the internet. It's kind of like Sasquatch. There's pictures of them, but they're kind of grainy and black and white, and you don't know for a fact. Yeah, you know, it might be a doctored picture, but once you meet these people in real life, and you're like, hey, wow, this is pretty neat, and then when you spend time together and you realize, yes, this can work. You know, you don't need John Boehner and Nancy Pelosi telling you what's going on. And the modern status will complain about John Boehner and Nancy Pelosi, but rather than go without a John Boehner and Nancy Pelosi, they will accept a John Boehner and Nancy Pelosi because obviously everything's going to go down the toilet bowl without them. And my thing is, if we can survive in spite of them, we can definitely survive without them.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And I same thing happened to me. I mean, as soon as I decided I was going to go to this festival, I posted in there and kind of asked a couple questions, one relating to the broadcast, which you so generously gave me some tips on how to actually do that. Definitely appreciated. And then I think once I posted in there, I got like 5 friend requests. And then when I got back from the festival, it was like probably Monday. I got like 20 or 25 friend requests from like everyone there. So it was really neat. And now like I used to have my newsfeed used to be full of just stupid shit all the time. But now it's just like nonstop like voluntarism and things like that. So it's awesome. It kind of revamped my fascist book page, just to say the least.
That is one of the benefits of going to a Liberty Fest. It will fix your face bitch newsfeed.
indeed it will.
And you'll get lots of bacon.
True. So even if you don't believe in liberty or you don't like it or you like the state, just come for the free bacon.
It's not necessarily free.
Well, come for the bacon. It'll be worth the trip.
it's liberty infused bacon. So there's bacon roofies in there. They'll knock out the statism.
That's good. So I guess let's before we move forward onto another subject, I'd like to give for those that did not read my write up on the festival, give my idea of what kind of events there were at this festival. There was one on Friday night that I'm really really sad that I had to go to work and miss that one. But Statum as religion. That's an interesting subject for me, and I would have liked to have heard Mary's presentation. I'm sure that was probably taped, so excited to look at that one.
I'm not sure if that actually happened, that presentation.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I mean, there was a lot of stuff that was kind of cluster bleepy on Friday night. It may have, I don't know. One of our friends, his father had passed away, so a number of us had wound up going down to Kalamazoo to the funeral home to pay our respects and provide support for our friend.
Gotcha.
So,
okay.
So I wasn't there to know if that had happened or if the presentation happened, but I don't think that it did. I could be wrong.
Okay. All right. Well, I guess I'd miss out on that then. But yeah, I mean, another event that happened on Friday, Freedom Through Entrepreneurship. That would have been interesting. Saturday morning was when me and my co-pilot got there. Polyamory one did not happen. I know that for sure. But we did go there and have a discussion. Interesting subject. Not really sure what I think about it yet, but nonetheless, it's an option for some folks if that is their cup of tea, so to speak. Yoga in the Grass with Stephanie Murphy. I'm really sad that I didn't get an interview with her because I kind of knew she was, but like I didn't know who she was. If that makes sense, I didn't know she came all the way from New Hampshire, and I would have loved to get an interview with her. Came home and watched some of her interviews with, I think she'd won with Jeff Berwick, and she's been on, I think she's on Free Talk Live too at one point, and she does the Pork Therapy too, that radio show, and it would have been really neat to talk to her.
Let's talk Bitcoin.
Yep, that's true. She's also pretty heavily, I think she's pretty heavily involved in Free Aid too, and maybe that's somebody else. Okay.
Yeah, she's involved with the Free Aid at Pork Fest, and then just around New Hampshire.
Okay. Yeah, she seemed like an interesting person, and I think she's come every year to, maybe at least last year too, to the festival. So
two out of three.
Okay, well, hopefully she'll be there next year. I'd like to chat with her. Everyone really enjoyed her yoga, so that was a good thing. Freedom Farming, spreading the message of liberty. That was interesting. I learned a couple new things on how to spread this nonviolent consensual philosophy. Nonviolent compassionate communication. Interesting. We've already discussed that. Then the Bitcoin roundtable. That was probably my favorite event that was held there.
I just started using Bitcoin a week before the fest. A couple Sundays ago, it was the Sunday before Liberty Fest. Bruce, who I believe was on the panel and one of the organizers of the fest, he helped me download and set up my first Bitcoin wallet because I just haven't gotten around to it. I mean, I'm usually a pretty slow adapter of technology, mm-hmm. and the fact that my cell phone doesn't have big giant numbers in a flip is kind of a miracle. But I set it up and he donated $1 to me. You know, right then and there, $1 worth of Bitcoin. So I'm looking, I'm like, okay, this is kind of neat. And I'm watching the confirmations come in. I'm like, hey, wow, this is pretty awesome. And then I started using it and I accepted Bitcoin payments at the fest. I did pretty good as far as making Bitcoin off of the meals. And then I made my first purchase because Rick and Melissa had their little stand going, and
Melissa, is that the one with the stateless salsa?
Yeah. Melissa makes the stateless salsa and the apple butter and all that other stuff. So I got a couple things of salsa. I got the hot, I got the mild, and the hot is kind of hot, but I like it. And then of course I had to get the apple butter because I grew up eating apple butter crepes that my grandmother used to make when I was a little kid. I don't know how to make crepes, so probably have to go on the internet and figure out how to make it. But anyway, I made my first Bitcoin purchase, and I was rather excited about it.
Yeah, indeed. I purchased Bitcoin for the first time like a month and a half ago to buy some silver. It was a pain in the butt to buy without a bank account, but nonetheless, I was able to figure it out.
Yeah, well, there was Amagi Metals is accepting Bitcoin for metals purchases.
Yeah, I know Velt Gold and Sons of Liberty Mint are, and I went through Sons of Liberty Mint. Actually, I went through both of them. I did one I did one for each, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm probably going to use Bitcoin to go to the Agora Fest in September in Minnesota.
Right on. That Bitcoin roundtable was a lot of interesting people, and I've had some questions I needed answered. I will definitely post that video in that write-up that I did, whenever the videos become available, I'm actually linking all those in. So there'll be a couple updates. I guess, stay tuned for that if you want to actually watch those presentations, or just find the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition on Facebook or on YouTube. I apologize. The point was pretty cool.
Yeah, there's three videos posted that I know of already. Adam's speech, and I think the nonviolent compassionate communication. I can't remember what the third one was.
Good question. It was Cal Molinay's Spreading Anarchy workshop.
Yeah. But going back to the freedom farming, when it comes to reaching out to people, and I'm kind of lucky that I'm in an area where even the white Republicans are getting sick and tired of the cops, because because up here you got the local cops, you got the county sheriff, you got the state troopers, and all they do is road piracy. I mean, there's no real crime up here to speak of. When you listen to the news going to work in the morning, you get the Coast Guard report about some jackass that got trapped in the ice while fishing or something like that. No, seriously. You hear about traffic accidents, and I mean, it's really rural, small town, type junk. Somebody's butter churn broke down and they're starting a GoFundMe or something like that. Just talking to different people and talking about, like the war on drugs and things like that, and putting it in a manner that people can understand. And I was so bummed out I couldn't get to the freedom farming, the spreading the message.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, Mike wanted me to jump in and talk a little bit about things that I do. But as far as providing an alternative, I'm a firm believer that people look for liberty because they're tired of the state. They're tired of tyranny specifically. And once you realize that the state can only provide tyranny and can never provide liberty, they're a lot more susceptible to the message of liberty and voluntarism, mm-hmm. abolitionism, all these other things. So it's like, everybody says, well, how did you find liberty? And most people say, oh, Ron Paul. No, I didn't find liberty through Ron Paul. I knew there was a problem, and I didn't need Ron Paul to tell me that there was a problem. And basic problem-solving skills tells you that when there's a problem, you do the opposite of the problem.
Yeah, you don't continue doing the same thing.
Yeah. Now, granted, Ron has carried the message of liberty, or at least limited liberty, because he's a Constitution humper. But mm-hmm. It's an understanding that what you're doing is no longer working. And if you look at substance abuse and mental illness and things like this, people have a tendency to finally hit their bottom. And when they hit their bottom, they know that that's when they have to start doing things differently. The current way of doing things is not working. So that is the first step of going into recovery, realizing that there's a problem and making the conscious decision to change and to seek recovery. So by realizing that the state is always a losing proposition, government is a casino, all right? You put money in, every once in a while you get a little bit back out. Your rights are the chips, and elections are just a game of chance that you're going to gamble your rights away on.
Yeah.
So once you get that realization, and you can read Rothbard and Franz Oppenheimer and Albert J. Nock and all these other guys, and I really don't think that all that stuff is necessary. And yeah, you can have the intellectual arguments and everything else, but once you understand that the state is a losing proposition and making things happen through violence is morally wrong, not to mention it doesn't provide a very good result, you really don't need a whole lot more than that. So yeah. And I could talk about all these different philosophers and the ideas that they put out, but it's really not that necessary. I think it tends to overcomplicate things.
It definitely can. It definitely can. Let's get back to, go through some of these other events. I'm not sure. I'm guessing next year. Guessing it's probably going to be about the same format. I know they did the MPLC wrap up to get feedback.
Yeah.
But I'm guessing there's still going to be quite a few presentations, and maybe split between all of the presentations were at the pavilion this year. And I think they might split it up a little bit. next year. I'm not sure, but either way, polycultural farming. I was with Jamin and Karen.
Jamin.
Yeah, that was really interesting. I've always been kind of interested in the homesteading, gardening, organic gardening type thing, and what they're doing on their property is honestly insane. They're doing quite a bit.
Yeah, I've been to their place. Joe, the really tall guy, and I drove down there, I think it was last October, maybe late September, something like that. But anyway, we drove down there and got a chance to see the property and hang out with them for the weekend. And you take a look at the yard, because they've got all these different plants, and if you don't know what you're looking for, you're like, my God, it's like a jungle in there. And I look at all this overgrowth, and you know, it's just a mess. And then as they're going through and they're pointing at each different type of flower, plant, and everything else, and they're lifting this up and, you know, moving that over to the side, you actually see and get an appreciation for what they're doing. I mean, for example, they've got the vegetables that do better shaded, like a broccoli, underneath other plants.
Yeah.
And the other plants are providing the shade. You'll see these flowers, you know, popping up, and you're like, oh, well, that's kind of pretty, but what's that doing in your garden? And then you find out that has a tendency to chase away certain types of bugs or other critters that would come in there and gobble things up. Or maybe it, you know, helps to nourish the soil a little bit better. And then maybe like one of them, you pull the petals off and you throw it in a salad because it tastes like a radish.
Yeah. Yeah, they definitely know what they're doing.
Yeah, so once you understand what's going on and you're doing more than just looking at the cover of the book and you see what's actually in the book, it's like, holy cow, this is actually ingenious.
Yep. Yep, and it was neat looking at their, I guess, like custom, like pretty much self-sustaining greenhouse. That was pretty sweet. And then the mobile chicken coop. Never seen any invention like that before. They're doing quite a bit.
Yeah, what the chicken coops do is the mobile ones is you have a chicken coop, and it has wheels on it on like the backside. So you pick up the front, you know, just a little bit, and then you'll pull it forward. But what the chickens are doing is they're scratching at the soil, and they're gobbling up bugs, worms, and all that other junk. But they're also fertilizing the soil when they do their business. Mm-hmm. So they're tilling and fertilizing the soil, and then you move them, you know, to the next spot, and they do the same thing all over again. What's his name? Joel Salatin at Polyface Farms out in, I believe it's Virginia or West Virginia. He raises grass-fed beef, but what he'll say is, you know, hey, I grow grass, because, you know, he'll have his animals going out there, and you'll have the circle of life happening in the fields, because the cows will eat the grass, and then he'll bring in, you know, chickens that will feed on the maggots that are growing in the dung, and they'll spread the cow dung around, and the grass grows back even better.
Yeah, it's definitely neat.
Yeah, I mean, it's really a good example of working smarter, not harder.
Yeah, it definitely is. It definitely is, and unfortunately, I didn't have a chance to meet Jamin. Jamin. I'll never pronounce his name right, but I wish I'd have a chance to meet him. I know they did a couple presentations that weekend. Seems like they know what they're doing. So, okay. Then go ahead.
I just got feedback on Facebook. The statism as a religion topic did happen on Friday night. Mary went through a speech that she had prepared, and then we had a discussion about her art. So, okay. Awesome. So, yeah, live feedback.
Awesome. Good deal. So, yeah, I'll definitely keep a lookout for that video, and I'll share it with all of you as soon as I get it, because I think that's probably an important concept to grasp. I guess before we go to break, we can discuss Cal Molinay's we've had Cal on the show twice, and he was actually the one that told me about the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest and said, hey, if you can get up there, head up there. So, definitely appreciate Cal's push to come to that festival, because I wouldn't have known about it without him. His Spreading Anarchy workshop, I've watched most of the videos on that playlist, and he's honestly got the propaganda down. So he'll go out there and just just spread anarchy. Talk to people about he goes out with a sign, says, "Ask me why government is immoral." People voluntarily come over there, and he talks to them. And the majority of people already hold these philosophical principles of non-aggression principle and the axiom of self-ownership. So it was really neat to see him kind of explain that in person, and also some additional stuff that I didn't know about his path to where he is today. And also just to be able for him to field questions from the audience. There's a couple good questions that were asked on how to reach people on Facebook and things like that, which is pretty hard to reach people on Facebook. And I'm sure you know, Lou, it's just usually turns into just a shit show with people yelling at each other and no one actually listening to either side. But either way, it was really neat to hear Cal's speech and be able to hang out with him on Saturday. Did you have a chance to meet Cal, Lou?
Yeah, we got a chance to sit down and shoot the bull. I was supposed to do an interview with him on, I think it was Saturday we were all busy doing stuff, and then Sunday we're supposed to do it, and by the time I got the assault kitchen torn down, it was pretty late at night, so it didn't happen. So hopefully we'll be able to hook up in the virtual world and do it in the near future. But yeah, it was really nice to meet him. I've known him on Face Beast for a little while. And follow some of his work. I haven't seen too many of the videos, but I definitely follow the postings that are in the Liberate RVA Facebook group. And I was really looking forward to meet him. And yeah, he's a very nice, enjoyable person to chat with and shoot the bull. And
yeah,
so
yeah, definitely. Well, we are coming up to our final break. Stay tuned. Make sure to give us a call if you've got a question or a comment. Stay tuned, we'll be right back. Which will do when it takes a gold? Tear a dam upon the world
trade with a stamp of USA grade. Mr. President, members of Congress, you've been making a lot of noise about taking our guns away. But you might want to review history. 1835, Gonzales, Texas Territory. The authorities wanted to confiscate the big gun that protected that colony. You know what the people said? Come and take it, because they were willing to fight for their freedom and their guns. So are we.
Come and take it if you want it. Come and take it if you think you can. Come and take it, but I warn you, you'll have to pry it from my cold dead hands. We want the freedom that God gave us, so you best not cross that line. If you want this gun, you gotta come through us and take it.
One shot at a time. Just like Gonzales, we're keeping our guns.
doTERRA essential oils, true gifts of the earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the family physician kit. 10 certified pure therapeutic grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit EssentialNewParadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you. Health depends on you.
This is Niz from Disassociation Nation. As many of you know, I'm an avid vapor. And if you're like me, you're tired of being charged ridiculous amounts of cash for a disappointing experience when flavors just don't deliver. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to Vapor Renew, a Flavor West company. If you're into mixing and creating your own custom e-liquids, Flavor West has everything you need to make delicious, satisfying flavors. Doesn't matter if you're a flavor chaser or if you love the look and feel of those big, beautiful, puffy plumes. FlavorWest.com can provide you with everything you need. Let's face it, if you vape, e-liquid is an ongoing expense. And if you're a dripper like me, then you know that blowing through a $30 bottle of juice isn't unheard of. Why pay more than you have to? So for excellent quality juice made right here in the United States, head over to VaporRenew.com, where they have hundreds of flavors pre-mixed and ready to vape at the most reasonable prices you'll find. Use coupon code RENU for an extra 10% off your entire order. Great juice at a great price and 10% off. Support companies that support liberty by making your next purchase at VaporRenew. Or for mixing supplies, don't forget FlavorWest.com.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.
don't know how to be but angry.
And welcome back to Liberty Under Attack Radio, a Freedom Feelings Radio Network. Got a question for Lua myself. I got a comment. Did you attend the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest? If you do, feel free to give us a call. There's still plenty of time to call in. The number is 218-895-3818 or on Skype at FPRN Radio Live. So if you are just tuning in, I'm joined by Lousander Feen from Freedom Feens Radio.
Yo!
what's going on? yeah, if you want to check out his archives and such, go to freedomfiends.com, and you guys have some buttons for sale, don't you?
Yes, all sorts of buttons. As a matter of fact, I have some on the desk right in front of me here. Here they are. Yeah, tell me about your worms, or ask me about my worms, Freedom Feens, my personal favorite, state speech is hate speech. There's a couple of different fiend phones, Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom, Bipcot, No Gov License. And then probably my absolute favorite one is Buy Sheep, For Sheep, On Sheep. And that refers to the original draft of the Constitution, that refers to the actual Constitution because it's written on parchment, which is actually vellum, which is sheepskin.
Ah, okay, fair enough. Interesting. I brought that up because that commercial I always chuckle at that commercial when it comes on about the buttons. you guys have a little comic. You have some comical advertisements on there. So
yes, as a matter of fact, that's a play on the old Liberty stickers commercial.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
New things every day.
Yep.
So. I did have one question, because I didn't really see any other than maybe your debate with the gentleman that worked there. But I'm curious, in the history of the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest, were there ever any like open minarchists, or did you have any of the syndicalists, the anarcho-communists? Did you have any of them at the festivals, or has it always pretty much just generally been, proprietarian anarchists?
The first two fests, Jacob from New York State was there, and he's an anarcho-communist, but he's one of the warm and fuzzy ones. I don't believe that he wants to force everybody to adopt his ideas at gunpoint. He just thinks that he should put them out there, and maybe they'll adopt him, and that would make him smile. But he's not one of the bloodthirsty ones, because most of the anarcho-communists are actually just state-o-communists. They just don't like the current incarnation of the state, and they want to become the state. And force people to bend over to their will.
Yep, and set up those workers, laborers unions, or whatever they call them. Okay.
We have one guy. It appears that his views change on like a daily basis, but he has a tendency to lean more towards mutualism, syndicalism.
Okay. All right. Good deal. Good to know. All right.
Not too many mini status. We had a token mini status at the first one. it was somebody's boyfriend.
Okay. And did that person end up coming back, or did he end up grabbing on to voluntarism, or how did that play out?
He's not giving up on his constitution, and maybe one of these days he'll read the whole thing.
Yeah, possibly. So I guess the next question, I asked this to Cal on that live interview last Sunday from the festival, and I'm just kind of curious to get your take on it as well. What do you think is better, a Freedom Conference or a Freedom Festival? A conference would be like the New Hampshire Liberty Forum or Anarcho-Polco and Liberty Fest West. And obviously, the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest would be an example of a festival, and also Anarchon, which is the Liberate RVA's thing that's happening next week, I think. So Freedom Festival or a Freedom Conference, which one's better, or do you think there's a place for both of them, or what do you think?
And let's throw in Pork Fest, because I went to the Pork Fest in 2014. I like the festival atmosphere a lot more. It's a lot more laid back, relaxed. You have many different options, because I really don't go to the presentations. At Porkfest, the only presentations I went to were ones that were put on by my co-hosts on the show, like Bill Buford, Ben Stone, and Michael Dean. And I sat on a panel of how to do radio and podcasting. So I obviously went to that one, but I really didn't go to a whole lot of them. I was down in the speaking area, and I caught bits and pieces of some. I'd sit down and listen for a little bit, but I really didn't make that a big part of the trip. My big thing for these festivals is going around and meeting people that I'd never met before, seeing old friends, and just chatting around the campfire, around the assault kitchen table, you know, whatever. That's what I really like.
Yeah. Yeah, fair enough. So definitely a Freedom Festival for you then. I don't know. That was my first Liberty Fest, and I think I would enjoy both. And I did go to most of the presentations there, but I wanted to obviously get a taste of. I am one that likes to go to those presentations and kind of see what I can find out. But yeah, I mean, I actually it'd be nice to go to Porkfest next year. I just think it's plausible. So it'll probably just be. The one up in Michigan for a little while at least, I'm assuming.
Okay. Yeah, and Porkfest is a neat little experience. It's so much bigger. It's like 10 times bigger than Liberty Fest.
Wow.
And you do have a number of mini states there because you'll see the people with their signs, you know, vote for me and I will set you free, or vote for me and I'll give you your freedom back. And it's like, well, how'd you wind up with my freedom? And what if you don't win? Does that mean you're going to keep my freedom? But anyway, it's you probably should get out there. I know it's a long trip, particularly from where you are in Illinois. I've just added 9 hours to the trip for me to go out there. But I'll get out there next year probably.
Awesome. And I mean, that is hosted by the Free State Project, and their whole thing is to become the state, isn't it? Or get elected in and get voted in. I know it's not all of them, but I know especially they're in Free Keene. I know that's kind of their thing. So yeah, I would expect there to be, I guess, some mini status there.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, they want to use government to fix government. There's also a group that wants to use heroin to kick heroin. So, yeah, I can see where they're coming from, but, you know, it's like it's no different than going to a campaign for a tiny bit more liberty rally and somebody says, hey, I got an idea. Let's get elected and change the system from the inside. And that has been like the battle cry for, a couple hundred years, probably longer. I mean, at least a couple hundred years here in America. You know, and then also guys saying, well, if only we could get back to the Constitution, if only we could get the right people in charge. And quite frankly, they sound like defenders of state socialism when you ask them about what happened in the Soviet Union, because they make the same excuses.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. There was one thing I wanted to bring up. I just liked the Facebook page a few days ago. Campaign for a longer leash.
Oh yes.
Tell us a little bit. That's I've read some of those posts, and it's pretty comical. So why don't you tell the listeners a little about that little project?
Oh yeah, it's a view of the political process from the vantage point of dogs and cats. You have the dogs that are leashes, and you have the cats that are catarchists. And it was actually inspired by Campaign for a Tiny Bit More Liberty, because when I used to talk about them on the radio show, you know, I'd call them Campaign for a Tiny Bit More Liberty, and then I started calling them Campaign for a Longer Leash. And one of them started popping off in the MPLC group one evening, and the next morning I woke up and I see a couple notifications saying, you know, you've been invited to like this new page called Campaign for a Tiny Bit More Liberty, or Campaign for a Longer Leash. And then I look at the next thing. It says you've been made a administrator of this, and I'm looking at it. It's like, okay. And we just started going, and things that you'll see on there, you'll see quotes that are changed around to reflect the language that a dog would use if a dog could speak English. For example, the Frederick Douglass quote. There's a picture of two dogs holding each other's leashes, and it says, when you attach a leash around another dog's ankle, don't be surprised when you find the other end around your own neck.
Interesting.
So, or the, what is it, Patrick Henry quote, crouch down and lick the hand that feeds you, and may your leash rest lightly upon you.
Yeah, that's so funny.
Of course, the profile picture is a golden, or yeah, no, not golden retriever, a yellow lab holding a leash in his mouth. And that's just like the ultimate ultimate bit of subservience. And I got the idea for that from a Butler Schaefer quote. It says, people that carry a constitution in their pocket as a symbol of their liberty remind me of dogs that have learned to carry their own leashes in their mouth.
Hmm. Yeah, that's a good way to put it. That's definitely a good way to put it.
So instead of looking for actual true liberty, the folks with Campaign for a Tiny Bit More Liberty and all these other mini-status groups, they're just actually looking for a longer leash because they don't want true freedom. As a matter of fact, one of my friends, and he's a lot more sympathetic towards our cause than the constitutional slavery. He even said at one of the rallies, he says, what are we doing here? I mean, are we trying to get freedom or are we just trying to get a longer leash? So he's actually incorporating it. As a matter of fact, he's one of our biggest fans.
Awesome. Awesome. So we kind of stopped through the I want to give the listeners a little bit of more of an idea of what happened on Sunday and also the end of Saturday. Saturday there was a presentation on 9/11, the facts. There was Add Freedom to Your Life Today with Mental Discipline. I didn't go to either of those. Then obviously Saturday night was when Lou had a friendly debate with the gentleman about capitalism and money and things of that nature.
Let me jump in on that real quick.
Yeah, go for it.
The one thing, because I was talking, we're discussing, worker-owned cooperatives and all these different things. The point that I made to him, and this is something that most people, the black and golds, would recognize. I personally have no problem if he wants to set up a worker-owned co-op where they all share in the fruits of their labor and everything else. I really don't care how he lives his life. Good for him. But are they willing to provide me the same consideration and courtesy? Are they willing to let me live my life the way that I see fit without sending goons after me? Say, no, you have to join our collective. And because if they want that, if they want people to be kept from having their own freedom, then, how are they any different than the state?
That's a good question. I'm kind of weary about that. I mean, mutualists. I have no qualms with mutualism. It's not. I'm not a groupie by any means. I don't really like. I like communicating, being with others, but I wouldn't want to be in a mutualist society per se. But I mean, once it gets a little more collective than that, like a syndicalism or anarcho-communism, I'm not. I'm kind of weary about them letting us. Live the way we want to. So I'm not sure. They obviously don't necessarily believe in freedom too much.
Right. Well, that's why I differentiated between Jacob, the ANCOM from New York, and the average ANCOM. He hopes that you will adopt his ideas. The other ones, they want you to adopt their ideas. And they're willing to use any amount of violence necessary to ensure that that happens.
Yeah. Yeah, that is true. Oh, there's one thing we didn't even mention yet about the festival. And this was when I tell people like about it and I put up the picture, like people were some of my fellow anarchist friends, online friends, they got a good chuckle. The spontaneous order tent. It's definitely comical.
Yeah. That was started at the first fest, and there were absolutely no presentations that were planned or scheduled or anything like that. So if somebody wanted to go and give a presentation, they would put their name on a little board at what time and they handle their own publicity. Or if people went by there to see what was going on, they might happen to see it on the chalkboard. And if they want to have a presentation or a discussion, conversation, whatever, they could. So it's whatever winds up happening in there. Now, at the very first fest, it turned out that the spontaneous order tent was mostly just used for sitting around shooting the bull with each other. And that's fine, because me personally, I could care less about all the different presentations and stuff like that. But last year, the spontaneous order tent was used for the for the presentations, and it wasn't 100% spontaneous because it was a little bit more planned out in advance. So, for example, like Will Coley, who was there last year but didn't make it this year, he gave a speech on 2,000 years of liberty and how liberty brings us all together. So, but a lot of the time was spent in there, you know, with the conversations, particularly in the evening time after all the presentations were done, and people just get together, shoot the bull, or maybe they're eating their dinner in there, whatever.
Yep,
it's anything goes.
Yep, awesome. I'm curious for next year. And I know we've kind of got a couple. Actually, we'll go through this first. On Sunday, there was meditation, spiritual anarchist discussion group. Unfortunately, I was asleep for those. And then
you're meditating.
I was meditating unconsciously, I suppose. And then yoga in the grass with Stephanie Stephanie Murphy again, the one from New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. And then Exporting Liberty was with Will Coley, and he didn't make it, so obviously that one didn't happen. And then Kokesh and the MPLC or the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest wrap up for next year. So I guess the next question: what do you see for next year's festival?
Okay, well, I didn't really catch too much of the wrap up in the feedback session. I do know that it's going to be the last weekend in August, so I'm pretty sure the dates on that are the 26th through the 29th, and the reason for that is those were the only dates that were available for us. I believe it was either that or Labor Day weekend. But I know that there's going to be a more concerted effort to get the vending a little bit more organized and promote the vending for like food or different things like that. So I know this stuff's going to happen over the next year. I'll probably take a small part in it, but being that I live way up here away from everybody else, and the only thing I could do is get on like a Google Hangout or a Skype call to participate.
Yeah.
So, and I did one or two of those in preparation for this, like shortly after I moved up here. But I'd really like to see that a bit more organized and advertised so that people are more encouraged to bring their stuff out. And last year we had a Facebook group for vendors and for speakers, or two separate groups rather. And people were able to say, hey, I'm going to be doing this on this day. You know, like for example, I did a steak dinner. So I advertised that I was going to be doing steak dinner on Sunday night, you know, to generate interest, take orders and things like that. And it worked out pretty well. So I'd like to see us get back to that.
Yeah. Yeah, I had no complaints about. I know some other people wanted more spontaneous order, and they wanted kind of the presentations not scheduled so tightly around. Like they wanted a break for like lunch and dinner because I mean people coming together over food is probably one of the best ways for people to communicate. I guess my only minor complaint, and it worked out fine, was the lack of vendors. But I mean, if that's other than that, I mean, it was a fantastic time. And there's one subject I wanted to kind of discuss with you. What are your and you use the term like I heard the term from somebody else, but you use the term. I've heard it on the Feens as well as this evening. Tonight's broadcast, but what's your take on celebritarians?
Of the celebritarians that I've met, it's really a mixed bag. I mean, there's some that I felt were, you know, really nice, genuine people. They're the same in person as they are in a presentation. You know, like let's say somebody's giving a speech and you perceive them as being warm, friendly, compassionate, approachable, easy to talk to, like Ben Stone. Ben Stone, who is a celebrity in the community, is just as nice as could be. I mean, people have gone over to his camper at Pork Fest to meet him, and you know, because they wanted to introduce themselves and say hello, and he would invite them to sit down for a coffee or a soda or something like that. That's the type of person that I like as far as celebrities in the community go. Now you have the other ones that are just Can I say dicks?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Okay. All right, yeah. Yeah, they're dicks because they're under the impression that, well, I'm a very big person in this tiny community. Therefore, you know, you, peasant, you know, I will say hello. I'll sign your autograph if you want, so long as you buy my book or, you know, buy this or, you know, whatever. And, yeah, they're really dickish. They look down upon people, and they're just not really that friendly. So, but I mean, really, you have to look at if somebody becomes a celebritarian, why are they a celebritarian? You take somebody like Bob Murphy, who is very intelligent and can speak eloquently on his issues, or Tom Woods, who's just an amazing speaker. You know, yeah, I mean, with them, you know, I think that their celebrity status is earned. But if you take somebody that can't speak well on, you know, the things that they're talking about, and, or maybe they're just a sock puppet for somebody else, you know, really, you know, how are you a celebrity? I mean, have you actually accomplished anything? So, but yeah, and that, I guess those are my thoughts on celebritarians.
Okay, all right, good deal, good deal. I think that was a good way of explaining it. So I guess probably the last question for this evening would just be, and I ask this to every single person I interviewed last weekend, and because I think it's important, it's kind of neat to see the answers you get when you ask this question, and this is a very important one. So what is the best strategy for restoring liberty?
Increase the state. Seriously. Seriously, we've talked about this before. How did you become a libertarian, anarchist, voluntarist, abolitionist, whatever you want to call yourself? Is it because, you know, the wrong people just happen to be in charge at this present time? You know, one of Ben Stone's analogies is liberty is like oxygen. When you can breathe just fine, you don't think nothing of it. You don't even think about oxygen. When was the last time you said, wow, I am so happy that there's so much oxygen in the air out there? You know, it's when you can't breathe. It's when you have that lack of liberty due to the increase in tyranny that you realize that you have the need for liberty. So it's actually the increase in tyranny that has fueled the demand for liberty. And just like the pendulum of the two-party system, you know, people get sick and tired of the Republican screwing them and kicking them in the nuts, and they say, well, I'm going to vote for the Democrat to screw me and kick me in the nuts. And after 4 or 8 years of that, or maybe even 12, they say, you know what? I'm sick and tired of getting kicked in the nuts by the Democrat. I want the Republican to kick me in the nuts again. And eventually, after being kicked in the nuts so many times, people finally say, you know what? What if there was a possibility of not getting kicked in the nuts? And where mini-statism justifies this, you know, justifies a political action and says, well, would you rather get whipped by the slave master 10 times or 20 times? You know, well, of course, 10 would be better, but it shouldn't be a goal. And for the mini-statist, 10 times is the goal. Yeah. But they never provide that option of why not escape the plantation? And as Harriet Tubman said, I freed 1,000 slaves. I could have freed 1,000 more if only they knew they were slaves.
A little Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah,
definitely.
Or even Frederick Douglass, because I mean, people, you know, these people say, well, we just have to vote for the right people to restore liberty. No, you don't get liberty by voting. You don't get liberty by other people doing it. And what Frederick Douglass said was, you know, I prayed for 20 years for freedom, and my prayers went unanswered until I prayed with my own 2 feet. And he was an escaped slave.
Awesome. Yeah, that was a good answer. I've never, like, that's not one I expected to get, but you're exactly right. I mean, that's how it started for me. I mean, granted, I did start out a little conspiratorial, but nonetheless, it was the fact that I recognized that we are slaves. I think you're exactly right.
Yeah, and the state is a losing proposition. It can never be good. It can never be kind and loving and benevolent. I mean, at the best, it could be indifferent. But it can never be used for good. And if you look at the entire history of the state from the very first emergence of the state to now, you know, granted, technology has changed, but their only tool is violence and compulsion. Nothing else has changed. So the way I see it is you provide an alternative to the state. You know, get off the plantation, get on the blockchain. You know, you got a problem with the, you got a problem with the Fed. All right. Well, don't go marching around screaming out at the Fed. Get on the blockchain. You can take a look at that anytime you want.
Yep. You know,
you don't have to worry about hyperinflation with Bitcoin. You know, provide an alternative, provide something that shows that the state is obsolete. It's always been obsolete and you don't need it. And as example, police brutality, you know, everybody's up in arms about, you know, about the cops being road pirates and enforcers and all this other stuff. Okay. So what's the alternative? I did an interview not too long ago with Dale Brown of Threat Management Center down in Detroit.
Oh, yeah.
He provides private security in the city of Detroit. He's in rough neighborhoods, and he has regular people not only paying their property tax, well, half the city doesn't pay property taxes, but not only paying for the government cops that don't do doodly squat, but also paying his fees because there's a market for security and protection, but there's not a market for law enforcement and government cops.
Another great way to put that. So we are coming to the end of the show. So what's next for the Freedom Feens? When can people catch you on the show?
I'm generally on every other Wednesday night. I'll be on this coming Wednesday night and the following Wednesday night. I'm filling in for Diana Davison this coming Wednesday. But you can catch the Adam Kokesh interview this Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern time. And Ben and I will talk a little bit about that and talk a little bit more about Liberty Fest. Go to freedomfiends.com and download all the episodes and worms.
Well, Lou, I definitely want to thank you for coming on and talking with me today. It was definitely a pleasure speaking with you, and you've got a lot of good insight. So I definitely appreciate your time.
Well, thanks for having me. I really appreciate the invitation. Yep. And good luck to you and all the rest of your shows.
Thank you very much. You too, sir. All right. Well, there you have it. Lou Feens from freedomfeens.com. Make sure to go check that out. Listen to the podcast and buy some buttons. And stay tuned for Davi Barker and Derek Bros in the coming weeks. And make sure to check out the articles at libertyandattack.com. Other than that, have a good evening.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us, or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.